लास्ट सेशन और लास्ट स्टैंडर्ड AS 29 प्रोविजंस कंटिजेंट लाइबिलिटीज कंटिजेंट असेट्स. ओके, कैन यू डिफाइन फॉर मी और कैन यू एक्सप्लेन मी दिस एटलीस्ट द टू वर्ड्स प्रोविजंस एंड लाइबिलिटीज, व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस? Can you define these three terms for me?
Provision is just an estimate, can be changed in the future. Liability is a fixed, whatever liability we have to pay.
Provision is estimate, liability is final.
We have to pay the fixed amount.
Known, okay, chalo, known. And contingent is?
With some conditions.
What is difference between provision and contingent liability then? When will you call it a provision? When will you call it a contingent liability?
Contingent liability is a liability which depends upon the contingency of the events. If the contingent liability becomes material and it is against the company or against the institute, or suppose there is a case. In the case, if we win, there is no contingent liability. If we defeat, then the contingent liability becomes actual liability. So it depends upon the contingency of the events.
Okay, are you saying that provision is for the event which has already occurred, or you know that you have to pay, but
we have to, for example, provision for retirement benefits, I have to provide in my books of accounts.
So provision is event occurred, but amount uncertain. Can I say that? Only the amount is uncertain, liability is certain.
Liability accrued liability.
Liability is accrued or I have to pay,
yeah.
Only the amount or timing is uncertain.
Uncertain.
Can I say that?
Yeah, it is an estimate.
Okay, and contingent liability?
Contingent liability is an uncertain event. I don't
that
know.
That means event is uncertain.
Event is uncertain, amount is also uncertain.
Event and amount, two things are there, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You are saying whether event is certain or not?
Yes. Yes.
Event. In contingent liability.
Just like
not certain. Not certain.
Event is uncertain.
Yes.
Event
yes,
is certain
yes.
Or uncertain?
Event is there. Event is there. It may or may not happen.
Okay. Event may be certain. May be uncertain.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. But
amount
totally uncertain.
Cannot be arrived at.
Totally uncertain.
Cannot be estimated, sir.
Amount can also be certain and uncertain.
Certain uncertain. Yeah, yeah. Okay. If even is not certain. Then.
For provisions like retirement benefits by actuarial valuation, the amount can be estimated.
Provision amount can be estimated. Contingent liability also amount can be estimated.
Yes. That is like the retirement benefits.
Okay. What happens to a corporate guarantee? Corporate guarantee is a contingent liability or not? Contingent? Why? Event is uncertain. What about the amount? Amount is known, event is unknown. So it is possible in contingent liability that amount is certain, right or wrong? In contingent liability also amount can be certain. Okay, what is a corporate guarantee? Suppose My subsidiary wants to take a loan, okay, and I give a guarantee to the bank that you give a loan. If he does not pay, then I will pay. That is a guarantee, bank guarantee or corporate guarantee. Yes, amount is certain or not? Event is uncertain. Amount I know. So my contingent liability maximum amount is 1 crore rupees. If he does not pay, maximum 1 crore I will pay. That is amount is certain, event is uncertain. So contingent liability also, there can be a possible obligation or a present obligation. However, provision, it is always a present obligation. Liability, there is always a present obligation. Contingent liability, not always possible obligation, there can be present obligation also. Okay. When there can be a present obligation but a contingent liability, what is the scenario? Can you tell me? Chances of payment of liability is remote. Okay. For example, I have lost a case in High Court. Okay. And High Court has told me to pay, say, 1 crore rupees to someone. Okay. Is it a present obligation? Yes, because I have already lost a case. But I feel that I will not be paying the amount. What I do is I go and file a case in Supreme Court. Or income tax has raised the demand of 5 lakh rupees. Liabilities, present obligation? Yes. But I go and appeal against that demand. Contingent liability? So present obligation, but chances of payment is less than it is contingent liability. Possible obligation is there's a case which has not been decided yet. So it's a possible obligation. So event is uncertain, possible obligation. Event is certain, but chances of payment is uncertain, again contingent liability. Okay, liability in provision in both the scenario, event has occurred, event is certain, present obligation. Liability is when the amount and the timing is certain. Provision is when the amount or timing, at least one of them, is uncertain. Clear? Okay, what is, there is electricity bill which comes in April. Say 5th of April, 31st March, what do I do? Liability or provision? How do you account for electricity bill? How do you calculate the amount? Based on Feb month's amount or based on March month bill, which comes in April?
Based on March month.
Which comes in April?
Yes.
So the amount is certain?
Certain.
Payment of timing is certain. You know that you will pay on 7th of April, 10th of April.
Yes.
So timing is also certain, amount is also certain. How can it be provision?
It is a liability.
Okay, one more difference is, one second sir. Provision is booked expense to provision. Liability is booked expense to creditor. Liability is never booked expense to provision, or provision is never booked expense to creditor.
In case of letter of credit, the event is certain, amount is certain.
Letter of credit after the bank has disbursed the amount or before the bank has disbursed the amount? Before, then liability is also not certain, amount is also not certain. If the person does not deliver me the goods, then I will not ask the bank to pay the amount for the goods. After it is disbursed by the bank, yes, both are certain and hence it is a liability. Clear, sir?
Thank you.
LC? LC is not a contingent liability also. Contingent liability is when see, I have received the benefits or there is a... See, both the events, asset and liability, both will happen in future. That means they will deliver me goods and I will make the payment. So both things happening in future, I don't need to record a contingent liability.
Okay, so one is indigenous order and one is the other is the import proposal. In case of import proposal, there is a provision of getting a higher amount of customs duty and other packing forwarding charges. So in case of that, so import procurement, what happens? When we'll go for liability or provision? In indigenous purchase, local purchase, so we have a fixed amount of purchase order and our bill getting a...
So if amount is uncertain, you will go for provision.
So we'll make a provision for the import also.
See, when do you record import purchase? When do you record purchase in case of import purchase?
Suppose the order is placed before the 31st March, we have to go for the provision.
Do you record purchase when you have given the purchase order?
Yes.
No.
Why?
Hence you are getting this question. This question itself is a little not correct, because you don't record purchase when you raise a purchase order. You record purchase when it reaches your destination, your port.
No, not necessary, sir, because we have a order placed before 31st March and we are expected delivery date is suppose May or June, whatever.
Purchase should be recorded when risk and rewards are transferred by the seller to the buyer. That is when purchase should be recorded. Risk and rewards are transferred when the goods are in your control. The goods are in your control when it reaches your port. And when it reaches your port, you know what is the import duties and all that.
That means in case of import procurement, suppose if it is on FOB basis, if it is boarded, so you have to take accounts before 31st March?
Yes, in that case you will record purchase, and then that purchase will be at estimated value. And yes, then see, but then you will not make a provision for this your import duties and all.
Import duties,
because the timing will happen in the next year. The import duties, yes, will have to be paid in the next year, so you will not make that provision now. Provision is made when? When is a provision made? What is a liability? Can you define liability for me?
The payment which is to be made. I mean, we know that certain obligations. Yes.
Why will there be obligation to pay? Because benefits have been received.
Benefits has been received. That's
so. Liability is when benefits have been received, but payment has not happened.
Then only the liability.
So now your services of that custom or duties have not. You have not received those benefits. So you will not record that liability.
Then you mean to say, sir, the LC cases, we need not book the amount.
LC cases, before you have asked the bank to disburse, you will not book any amount. LC cases, only when you have asked the bank to disburse, that is when you book the amount. Contingent also, it will not come. Oh. Because you have not received the goods. Goods are not in your control. See, LC is not a contingent liability. LC में आपका क्या होता है, एक अमाउंट सेट असाइड हो जाता है.
Perhaps LC will be a advance.
Yes, it will be advance or it is set aside. You can keep it in bank account also. You can keep it as restricted money or LC. You can, you have to account for in the asset side. And as
when
LC
will it be, when will it be capitalized? When the goods reaches to the port.
When the goods, if it is FOB, when it reaches the port of that port. And if it is CIF basis, or you call it CIP basis, I think.
CIF.
Then it, when it reaches your port.
There is a separate column in news.
Right. So that's what I said. LC will come on your asset side. It is not your contingent liability. LC will come on your asset side because your money has been blocked for that particular purpose. The moment you give the instruction, it will be released. Then you have to pay to the bank. So that limit has been blocked. So it is not.
In some cases, foreign purchases are made without making the payment. In that situation, perhaps it may become the contingent liability, because when LC is opened, 100% amount goes from our bank account to the bank, and it is irrevocable also. The amount remains in the custody of the bank, but it is irrevocable. So it appears on the asset side along with cash and bank. But in certain cases, when we don't make the advance payment, payment is against the delivery. In that situation, because we have placed the order, and there is a obligation to receive that amount, or proof of dispatch also is there. The amount, the goods has also been received. In that,
if the goods have been received, then it is a liability, not a contingent liability.
So suppose goods have not been received. In that situation, what is the status?
I don't think so. It will be a contingent liability. It will be booked as a liability in future. It is a future liability. Future liabilities are not contingent liabilities.
What is the difference between future liability and contingent
liability? See, as I said, benefits will be received in future, and the liability. Say, suppose I have placed the order for furniture, like PO. PO दे दिया आपने. PO के basis पे बाद में वो goods भी supply करेगा, बाद में आप payment भी करोगे. Will you book that PO as a contingent liability? Why not? Because benefits will be received in future, payment will happen in future. It is a future liability. It's not a contingent liability. Contingent liability is कि मेरा benefit जो मिलना था मिल गया. आगे benefit नहीं है, आगे सिर्फ liability है. And that liability may or may not happen. So it is a contingent liability.
Sir, suppose somebody has filed a court case.
So court case है. Court case अगर किसी ने मेरे against file किया है, there is no benefit in future. There is only a future liability. There is a liability which can happen or not happen in future. Benefits already received, so it is a contingent liability.
But there is no future liability, future obligation or something like that.
Future obligation, if the court case is against me and if I lose the case, then there is a liability, so it is a contingent liability. What type of contingent liability can occur in educational institutions?
Court case.
Demand notice from income tax department, yes. Service tax, income tax, any tax notice which you have received. Notice is not, demand notice, yes. Any demand notice you have received from any department, it is a contingent liability till the time you clear it. Or you accept it as a liability. Either you accept it as a liability or you keep it as contingent liability, depending upon your stand. If I contest it, If I go for appeal or if I, then it is a contingent liability. If I accept it, then it is a liability. Liability is a present obligation because of past event. If I am going to receive goods in future, event is also future. So it's not a liability. Liability is because of past event, which will result in outflow of economic resources. Provision is either timing or amount is uncertain. Contingent liability, either it can be a possible obligation. That means obligation itself is uncertain. Event itself is uncertain. Or it can be present obligation. In case of present obligation, either outflow is not probable or I cannot measure the amount. That means sometimes what happens is, sometimes court says you are guilty, but the amount of compensation will be decided in the next hearing. So when I am proved guilty, it becomes my present obligation, but the amount of compensation is not clear, which happens in the next hearing. So that becomes present obligation, but amount is uncertain. So it becomes a contingent liability. Okay, what is onerous contract?
Beneficial.
It's a contract which is no more beneficial. It's a burden. Okay, for example, actually I have given an example over here. Company X enters into a contract to lease a warehouse for 10,000 a month. Contract is cancelable within 2 years only on payment of 1 lakh. That means it's a non-cancelable contract for 2 years. But if you want to cancel within 2 years, you have to pay 1 lakh rupees. Company stops using the warehouse after 1 year. So a company has hired a warehouse or leased a warehouse. The amount or rent is 10,000 rupees per month. So, 1 saal ka ho gaya, 1,20,000, 2 years ka ho gaya, 2,40,000 rupees. Okay. It is using for 1 year. After 1 year, it says that now it's of no use, I will not be using it. Now, it has two options. Either to keep it with it and pay 10,000 rupees per month, or cancel the lease, and for cancellation, it has to pay 1 lakh rupees. These are the two options. Okay. Is there any benefit in that lease, first of all? After 1 year? No. When I entered into a contract, see, when I use a premise, I generate revenue out of that premises. When I use a warehouse, I generate revenue out of that warehouse. The moment I stop using that warehouse, I am not generating any revenue from that warehouse. So there is no benefit arising out of that warehouse, there is only cost involved in that warehouse. Right? Are you with me till here? When a contract has no benefit but only cost, that type of contract is called as onerous contract. Okay. This type of contract is called as onerous contract, which is there above. Okay. Now, onerous contract, it says that it will be treated as loss in the year in which it becomes onerous. So, on 31st March, I know that I am not going to use it next year. 31st March, it has become onerous contract. How do I provide for it? It says that whatever is the minimum obligation, unavoidable cost, that should be recorded as loss immediately on 31st March. Now, what is the unavoidable cost in this contract? 1 lakh. I can cancel the contract for 1 lakh. I need not pay 1,20,000 rupees. 1 lakh should be booked as loss immediately. Clear? Okay. Suppose I give it on a sublease for, one second, let me continue. Suppose I give it on a sublease for 5,000 rupees a month. So in the next year, I can recover 60,000 rupees. But I am going to pay how much? 1,20,000 rupees. It is still a onerous contract. Why? Because the benefits are less than the cost. Cost is 1,20,000, benefit is only 60,000. The loss portion of this 60,000, balance 60,000, should be booked as loss immediately on that 31st March. You should not wait for next year. Clear?
Contract cancelable within 2 years and 1 year has already passed. Now suppose the contract is for 3 years. So the 2 years amount is to be, you know, it will become loss for the organization.
2 years amount or 1 lakh, whichever is lower?
Whichever is lower. So whether it will come in the same financial year,
because yes,
matching concept, it will not contradict.
See, matching concept will come when there is a revenue and there is a cost. Here there is no revenue, only cost. Hence you have to book immediately.
Because it is for 2 years, whatever amount we are parting.
Yes sir, but there is no revenue in future. There is no benefit in future. See, as I said, suppose I give it on rent for 6,000, suppose. I take on rent for 10,000. I sublease on rent for 6,000. I have a loss of 4,000 per month. So into 12, I have a loss of 48,000. This 48,000 I should book as loss immediately. And next year what I should do is I should book rent of 6,000, balance 6,000 and income of sublease of 6,000.
If I am not subleasing, if there is no benefit at all in future, entire loss should be booked in the current year. Because there is no benefit in future.
Current year.
I am basically saying if there is some benefit arising out of the contract, then amount up to that benefit should be transferred in the next year. All other loss should be booked in the current year. That is the basic principle or the point. In this contract, suppose there is some other contract, say suppose you have a right to use some software for 2 years. After 6 months, you realize that it is of no use for me. अब मैंने तो 2 years का पैसा भरा है. Normally what I do is I do it as a prepaid expense, right? I paid for 2 years. I treat it as a prepaid expense, okay? And then I charge every month some amount or every year some amount. Now after 6 months, I realize I am not going to use it. So the balance 18 months, I write it off immediately. That is a loss which has happened. Immediately.
Is there any guarantee that sublease
will be for full 1 year?
Sir, if there is no guarantee, whatever loss is there in the future without any benefit should be booked immediately.
It is just a presumption.
Clear what is onerous contract and how to account for the onerous contract? You have to account for future losses immediately. Provision for depreciation. Do we use this term, provision for depreciation? Is it a provision? Provision for depreciation is a provision or not? Yes or no?
Yes.
Sure. Achha, why it's a provision?
We have no depreciation fund.
We have no depreciation fund. No, but what is provision? How does that answer my query? What is a provision? Provision is where the amount or timing is uncertain.
Just like retirement benefits, we make a provision, but we have no pension fund. So the same depreciation also, we provide depreciation, but there's no depreciation fund. That I interpret.
What amount is uncertain?
Here, useful life we are estimating. That's why it is uncertain. That's why it is a provision. It is reduction in the value of assets.
Sir, provision is created for future liabilities, isn't it?
Now, you said provision for depreciation. You have asked us provision for depreciation.
I am saying provision as a word or as a term or as an accounting term, provision is created for future liabilities. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Only the amount or timing is uncertain of future liability. Hence, I call it a provision and not a liability. Is provision for depreciation created for future liability?
Yes.
It is not a replacement provision. Why do you create depreciation? Why do you depreciate it? It's not for future replacement. Depreciation, as I said yesterday, logic is matching concept. I have matching to charge concept. Something. Mm-hmm. Or you might call it as use or use of that asset or...
It is the cost for reduction in the value of asset.
Right. So, it is charged to asset. It is you are basically valuing that asset every year by charging depreciation. It's not a provision. We might call it as provision for depreciation, but it is not a provision per se. As per AS 29, it is not a provision. Provision is for future liabilities where the amount or timing is uncertain.
Sir, I agree with you. In fact, provision should not be made. In case it happens, provision has to be made for the depreciation. The value of the entire asset has to be put in provision because ultimately all the assets are going to depreciate someday. It is zero. The value will be zero. So, if at all it is there, that has to be make the provision
for depreciation is not a provision. You might call it so, it's only a depreciation.
Yes, of course.
Okay. What is provision for bad and doubtful debts? Is it a provision?
Yes.
What is the future liability? See, we have been told provision for depreciation, provision for bad and doubtful debts. Is there a liability in future? Doubtful debts is not a liability. It's non-recoverability of an asset. It's not a liability. Provision for bad and doubtful debts, you might call it as provision, but it's not a provision. It's a charge to asset or charge against profit or whatever you might call it. It's
prudence and past experience, some provisions are kept.
It's not a provision. You might call it so, you might term it so, but it's not a provision in accounting terms.
Actually, some profit is kept aside. Profit, it is basically undistributed profit only. If it is not charged, then it becomes the capital kind of thing actually.
Provision for depreciation, provision for bad and doubtful debts, these are not provisions. Provision is substantial degree of estimation is required with regard to future, actually not expenditure, future payments. Accrual is goods or services that have been received but have not been paid or invoiced. So you accrue it. Present obligation, you have to record where there is a provision, whatever is the present obligation, probable outflow of resources and reliable estimate can be made. Then you have to record that provision, you have to value that provision or measure that provision and record as expense account debit to provision. Okay, there is something called as constructive provisions, constructive liability. Do you know what is it? Accounting standard 15 also has used this term constructive liability. Constructive liability is not a legal liability, but is a liability created because I have created certain expectations in the mind of my employees or my creditors or my shareholders. So suppose every year I give 10% bonus. So 10% becomes my constructive obligation to pay the bonus. Constructive liability to pay the bonus. Suppose I come and announce that I will pay 10,000 Diwali bonus to all my employees. Does it become my legal obligation? It is a constructive obligation. So there are two terms, legal obligation and constructive obligation. Theoretically, standards say that even constructive obligation should be accounted for. You should create a provision for such constructive obligations. Even AS 15, employee benefit says that when you keep on giving bonus every year at some particular percentage, you are creating a constructive obligation in the mind of employees and hence you should account for that constructive obligation.
In government organizations, constructive obligations is actually legal
obligation. In government organizations, yes, there is no constructive obligation, everything is legal obligation. Okay. You have made a provision for certain expenses, suppose advertisement of 100 rupees in 2009. Okay. 2010, you get the bill of advertisement or whatever that expense is of 70 rupees. However, you also have a bill of bonus which you have to give for previous year to some of your employees of say 20 rupees. Can you adjust that 100 rupees provision which you had created last year against this 70 and 20 and just reverse 10 rupees the balance, 70 plus 20, 90, I created 100, I just reverse 10 rupees. You are not allowed. You have to reverse 30 rupees and then charge 20 rupees. So prior period or not depends. Prior period when, if you could have calculated in the previous year but you forgot to calculate, then prior period. But suppose it was announced in the current year that I will give you bonus or the percentage or how to calculate the bonus or the amount was announced in the current year, then it is not prior period. Prior period is only when it was announced or you knew it last year but you forgot. It is error or omission. Clear? Okay, what happens to reimbursements? Do you incur reimbursement for a third party? Some expense incurred for the third party and then third party pays you. Do you incur that? Yes, right? Say suppose sponsorships or some event you have done for which certain cost will be borne by an advertiser, you incur it now and then he will reimburse you.
Yes.
That happens?
Yes.
Right? How do you account for such reimbursements?
From the receiving organization, I debit cash and credits the expenses where we had debited earlier.
So when I incur, I book?
Expense debit to cash.
To cash.
Yes.
And when I get back that money, I book cash.
Debit to expense. If it happens within the same accounting year.
And what if it happens in the next accounting year? So expense cash to income.
Then if it happens in the different accounting year, then I will book a receivable entry at the end of the year.
Then? If it happens in the next year, then?
Yeah. Then I will receive I will book a receivable entry at the end of the year.
So what entry will pass? Receivable?
Receivable account debit to expense. And in the next year, cash account debit to receivable.
So basically, you will see at the end of the year whether any receivable is still pending and then you create receivable.
Yeah. That is what
that is reverse way of accounting.
In this case, the original bills are sent to the grantee institution, which says that will be reimbursing. So we do not book the expenditure. We just send the bills to the grantee institution, and when we receive the money, that's simply kept in a transit head. And the expenditure is not involved. The expenditure is not booked in our institution.
Actually, no, but you have paid, right? You have paid for it. If you have paid for it, you have to account for it. How can you? That means you are saying, I received these two in the same year, and because I received these two in the same year, I have deleted both. I have not booked at all.
One alternative entry can be done. I can debit the debtor receivable and credit cash. And let that receivable be there till I get the money. When I will get the money, maybe in this year or the next year, I will credit receivable.
So
that is another way of doing.
Yes. So basically, the standard says that in income and expenditure account, you can net off this expenditure and this income. This expenditure and this expenditure can be net off. Or I directly book only balance sheet entries. That is possible.
Correct.
Or I book expense and negative expense.
Yes.
But in the balance sheet, it should be two separate things, a liability and a asset. Balance sheet, I cannot net off. That means suppose I have to pay to the printer and I have to receive from someone. Suppose I have not paid to the printer. I have to pay to the printer, I have to receive from someone. Then I have to book liability and asset both.
Receivable and payable both.
Receivable and payable both. I should not knock off receivable and payable.
Yes.
I should book both, receivable and payable. In income and expenditure account, I can knock off. So I will not have any income expenditure, fine, but I have to have asset and liability.
So whenever we make the payment from our source on behalf of some other party, first thing is that it becomes receivable from that party.
Third party, yes.
And
so first thing is you have to book these two entries.
Yeah.
Immediately. You should not wait for year end whether he is paid or not. You should book these two entries immediately. If you receive it, then this entry should be cash to receivable.
Otherwise, negative balance will.
So you should book this immediately. Receivable also immediately you should book. You should not wait for 31st March to book receivables.
That is practically there are rules in respect of sponsorship, which is not for the university, it is for the sponsor. We are doing something on behalf of the sponsor.
Right.
So we do that way.
Asset and liability, both you book.
Yeah, both.
Yes. So both should be booked. Yes.
Benefit is not for the university, it's for the sponsor we are doing.
Any questions on this? Anything remains unanswered? Let's come to contingent liability. So we have discussed what is provision. Provision is fine, right? You have to estimate the provision. Provision is created for those liabilities which is past event. But the event has occurred. Amount or timing is uncertain. So you estimate and you create a provision. Okay, audit fees. Audit fees is a provision or a liability? Liability. But you write provision for audit fees.
No. We debit the audit fees and create the creditor.
The creditor.
Because we have agreement with the audit firm
and we
for
know,
the next 3 years. We know the rate. It is predetermined.
We give them engagement letter. We know the amount. We know the timing. What is uncertain? Nothing is uncertain. You cannot say that your audit was lacking this, so I will not pay you this much amount. I will pay you only this much.
But the CAG audit fee is not determined. It is done. It is done at the end of the audit only.
Right.
So
right.
That needs to be estimated because it is on the basis of working days.
So in that situation, what will happen? Suppose the auditor doesn't turn up. It happens many times. They don't come for 2 years or 3 years.
Do you still have to pay the audit fees?
We have created liability.
Provision for audit fees, we are writing a liability for expenses. And under that head, liability for expenses, we are writing those things where concrete liability is there.
But
and for audit fee also, liability for expenses head. And writing audit.
You're talking about CAG auditors or normal auditors? CAG auditors, fine. CAG auditors, you can create provision because you are not sure when they will come.
CAG also charges audit fee.
So, CAG case, you can create provisions.
It is news for me that CAG is charging audit fee. Uh-huh. University is not paying any audit fee to CAG.
Let's talk about accounting, please. Let's stick to only accounting questions.
I am answering his question because he has raised, how is it possible that auditor doesn't turn up? If there is a single unit, then it is not possible because auditors have to come. But if it is a multi-unit organization where hundreds of offices are there across India, auditors will come at central place because budget and all are related, accounts are all related. But at individual units, they do not come for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years also. Because grants are not to be reimbursed by the government on the basis of the local units of the accounts. Those things are based on the central accounting units.
Okay, what all expenses you provide for? What is provision for then? What all expenses can you make provision for? Provision for retirement benefits, yes, it's a future liability, amount is uncertain, timing is uncertain, yes, and?
Provision for bad debt, bad and doubtful.
Bad debt?
Yeah.
I said provision for bad debt is not a provision.
Now we call it provision.
So I'm asking what is a provision and then you have to provide for that provision. What are those kind of expenses? Retirement benefits, fine. Employee benefits, fine. What else? Okay, someone said yesterday that we create an ad hoc provision of some percentage, 5%, 10%, we create ad hoc provision. Is it allowed?
Yes.
No, for some unknown cost. So we make some 5% provision. One of the institute, someone said that yes, we make an ad hoc provision of 5% or some percentage for some unexpected cost of current year, which we'll get in the, we will know in the next year when we receive the bill or something. Fine, not allowed.
No.
Okay, you can only create for, as I said, past event. So event has occurred, you know the event. Only the amount or timing is uncertain, then and then only you can create a provision. You just cannot create a ad hoc provision. That is manipulation of profits, perfect. Okay, any other expense you can think of that you make a provision for? No. Fine. Okay, contingent liability. Contingent liability, as I said, there can be two things. Possible obligation or present obligation. Okay. Possible obligation that arises from past events and existence will be confirmed only by occurrence or non-occurrence of one or more uncertain future events, which is not wholly within the control of the enterprise. So, there is a possible obligation which might arise in future. That obligation depends upon happening or not happening of a future event. And that future event is not in my control. That is a possible obligation. For example, a court case, very simple.
The contractor died mid-term before completing. Is that what you mean, such a situation? In a building contract, when the institution has executed a building contract with a contractor, but the contractor died. Could not complete the contract, but and he died.
No, but what liability do we have?
So the work will have to be re-advertised.
No, but do we as an institution have a liability?
We lose time, sir.
We lose time, but we don't have to pay someone, right?
No, but then we have to re-tender the work, the remaining work. So cost may...
So I cannot make a contingent liability that tomorrow if the earthquake occurs, then I will lose some expenses. That is not a contingent liability.
Occurs means the contractor had died.
Before 31st March.
Yes. And the remaining work had to be re-tender and cost difference will be there. Cost escalation.
No, that's not a contingent liability because it's not a past event, it's a future event. Future event is what? What is a liability for? For construction of building. Construction of building will happen in future and hence I will have to make the payment to the contractor in future.
Remaining part of the contract, sir.
That's sir, all.
I think it is a case of capital commitment that needs to be declared in the notes to the accounts, not contingent liability. The estimated amount of contract remaining to be executed.
Estimated amount of contract remaining to be executed, yes. But that is for existing contract, yes, not for a new contract. So she says the existing contract gets over because the contractor has died. It's a new tender, new contract for the remaining part. So that is not a
because there's loss of time, and usually if it's the same contractor, when there's loss of time, there's penalty levied.
No, ma'am, but still, it will not be a contingent liability.
All right, thank you, sir.
In case there is a more provision made earlier, and or in liabilities, more liability is there. So in future we came to know that I think it's no more liability.
Then you reverse the provision.
Right, and for that, for otherwise also, I suppose less liability on the provision is made, then we increase.
Then the balance is created or charged to expense in the next year. What so if I created a provision of 80 rupees, actual expenditure is 100 rupees, 20 rupees I charge in the next year when I know the actual amount.
Whether there will be any audit objection, I believe auditor may object that why you have made more provision earlier and now you are reducing it. I think there may be some kind of audit objection later on.
See, provision is an estimate. Estimate can go wrong. Estimate may not be perfect. That is why it is a provision. If it was perfect, it would have been a liability.
Because there is always one para that my colleague may agree.
So that's what I'm saying. Provision can never be.
For these things, provision is not made. Fine, next year we'll make it. And sometime there may be objection that over provision has been made.
Provision is an estimate. Whatever changes you have to provide in the current year. Whatever change in the provision, whether excess or short or whatever, will be provided in the current year.
But the thing, fact is that provision and liability changes the balance sheet, in fact.
Still.
Drastically it changes.
Still it is, maximum it will be a prior period item. If it was an error in the prior period, it can be a prior period item, but it will be provided in the current year. Okay, do you make a disclosure of any provision? Or how do you disclose the provision when you prepare financial statements? In the notes to accounts, what do you write? We just write these are the provisions and these are the amounts. So this is how it should be presented. Opening balance, new provision, reversal of existing provision, closing balance. These four things are mandatory. Opening balance, this is there in the notes, this you have to give in the notes. Opening balance, reversal of opening balance or reversal of any provision, new provisions and closing balance. These four information has to be given.
As a payment made during the year, that is also there.
So reversal is payment made during the year.
Okay.
When you make payment, you reverse the opening.
That's all.
Yes. Accounts format is for accounts, yeah. It's not for notes. This is for notes. Format is for balance sheet, income and expenditure, receipts and payment. Yeah. Is the format for notes also?
Notes to accounts also is part of that new format.
So this needs to be added because this is required by accounting standard
29. Estimate court case.
Is there any tool to estimate court case? That the lawyer will estimate. You have a lawyer representing your case, right? You yourself do it.
No. Lawyers are there. Counsel.
Lawyer is there. Counsel is there, right? That counsel will estimate you. And if it cannot be estimated, suppose it is very initial stage, then you have to say that the amount cannot be ascertained because it is very initial stage. If amount can be estimated, you give the amount. If it cannot be estimated, you state that the amount cannot be estimated.
Because this estimate is going to be different when judgment comes.
Estimates will always be different from actual, sir.
It will vary.
Estimates will always be different. There will be no perfect estimate.
Yeah.
Sir, it will be done internally only because certain cases will be done.
It can be done internally. If it cannot be done, you can take help of your lawyer or counsel and then you can estimate. That is the max you can do.
Sir, should this disclosure come along with the previous year's figure? Should this disclosure come along with the previous year's figure?
So also? Yes, it will have two columns, 2013, 2012.
Okay.
So it will have both. Okay. Contingent liability, I said there can be a possible obligation which will confirm in future based on happening or not happening of a certain event. Present obligation also can be a contingent liability if it arises from past event but it is not recognized. Why? Because it is not probable that outflow of resources will be required to settle the obligation. That means I feel I will not have to pay that any amount to settle the obligation. Why so? Because I have appealed or I think I will settle it out of court at a lower amount or I feel I can go to a higher court or whatever way. So I feel there will be no outflow of resources. Then it is a contingent liability. Reliable estimate cannot be made of the obligation. So if I cannot estimate the amount of the obligation, then again, even if it is a present obligation, I do not know the amount, then I cannot make a contingent, I cannot show it as contingent liability. Is it clear? I cannot provide it as a liability because I don't know the amount. So it will go as contingent liability. So even if it is a present obligation, in two scenarios, one, I am not sure whether I will be required to pay, there is possibility I will not be required to pay, and second, the amount cannot be estimated. In these two scenarios, I will make it a contingent liability and not a liability. Example of possible obligations, pending court cases, income tax investigations, guarantee given by a company to bank. Okay. When do you recognize contingent assets? Or do you disclose contingent assets? No. We are conservative, we follow conservative approach. We don't disclose contingent assets, we only disclose contingent liabilities. So basically asset is recognized when you are virtually certain, then you recognize it. Contingent asset, if it is more than 50%, then you disclose it. If it is less than 50%, you don't disclose it. So if it is probable, you are allowed to disclose. If it is possible or remote, you don't disclose. Example is I file a case against someone else. Okay. I file a case against someone else. There is a chance that I will win. The probability of me winning is higher. That means I will win compensation. In that case, I can record it as contingent asset. I have not won, so I cannot record it as income. Because I have not won the case. There is a chance that I can win the case and the chances are higher than 50%. Then I can show it as, disclose it as contingent asset. Liability, if it is virtually certain, recognize. Even if it is probable but reliably measurable, you can still recognize or you still have to recognize. Contingent liability, if it is probable, you disclose. If it is possible, you disclose. But if it is remote, you do not disclose. Any questions?
Converted into contingent liability by any organization?
Liability can be converted into contingent liability only if amount cannot be estimated at all. Otherwise, it is a liability.
No, I just give an example. Suppose there is a court case going on and the department has lost the case in the High Court, but there is no intent to make the payment. Liability is there. Suppose the court has given
decision. No intention to make the payment.
No intention to make the payment. And they file. They know it that they will lose in the Supreme Court. So, but they just prolong the case and they file the SLP in the Supreme Court. So that
will be, they can convert it into a contingent liability for the next 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 years. Yes.
So the liability arises when we actually enter into a contract.
Right.
Say, for example, we enter into a contract with CPWD for construction of a building.
Huh.
Now the preliminary estimate, it says the cost of the building is 8 crores. And accordingly, we have deposited 8 crores with the building. Now the building is completed. But when submitting the Form 65, the CPWD says that the cost of the building is 10 crores instead of 8 crores. So the university has actually entered into contract for 8 crores. But the balance of 2 crores, does the liability arises on behalf of the university? Because the contract is only for 8 crores, but they say it is 10 crores.
Sir, this is an operational question and not accounting question. If you think the liability arises, I can give you the accounting for that liability.
Because sir, while closing
it is a legal account, question. It's
while closing the account, we receive Form 65 which says the cost of the building is 10 crores.
Will you pay 10 crores to that person?
That's what. Because the decision is pending. The university has not taken any.
If decision is pending, then that 2 crores will be contingent liability, 8 crores will be liability. Entire 10 crores will not become contingent. 8 crores, it is final, you have to pay at least 8 crores,
yes.
You show it as liability.
Yes.
2 crores is not final, you show it as contingent liability. Just last 2 minutes to explain or to decide when it is contingent liability, when it is provision, when it is a liability. Basically, you have to decide first, is it a present obligation? If it is a present obligation, then whether the amount and timing is certain. If the amount and timing is certain, it is liability. If the amount or timing is uncertain and the obligation is present, then it is provision. A present obligation becomes a contingent liability if the outflow is not probable or amount cannot be reliably estimated. If it is not a present obligation, it is a possible obligation, then it becomes a contingent liability. Okay. The same thing in a different way or different fashion is represented by the decision tree above. You decide whether it is a present obligation. If yes, whether the outflow is probable. Again, yes, whether you can estimate reliably the amount, then you make a provision. If it is not a, if outflow is not probable or estimate cannot be made reliably, then it is a contingent liability. And if the outflow is possible, obligation is possible, again it is a contingent liability. Okay. If everything is clear, then Mr. Bakshi and MHRD will hope that you will implement it soon at your institutes and you will do proper accounting based on all the accounting standards. Okay, then thank you so much.